so that you can put it easily in your, I think one of the thing that about a title for us is a lot more, you also can it's actually short enough, you write it and it gives a very, you know, good summary for people to get interested, right, in your portfolio. So sometimes a better title would, so in a way here, this one, it's slightly long, it's otherwise it's good, but it might be changed, but just the title mostly is that, so that you can actually easily link it in your portfolio and people can see and feel, you know, get a very good summary quickly. Otherwise, if the title are very long or if the title was very descriptive, please just write something that's so concrete to what you have done in your portfolio most of the time. Okay, the business need. So here you're really building a lot more is understanding the Web3 technology stack. And let's, you know, you would have a chance to really understand conceptually what each components are, what the technology components are, and you would have a chance to build, to be much more of, you know, building an app, a web app that is connected. So it has backend, frontend. It is built based on tests, because Web3, you know, you really require, test is not optional. It is necessity, because everything has value. It's not like you're deploying something and it's for free. When you run it, you run it with money. Each of the block or each of the code that you're running will cost you money. So you have to start thinking about not making mistakes, because yeah, whatever you run, if the mistake was at the end makes it not, you know, if it ends up with error, you paid already, you're not gonna get. So it's really different mentality from a normal writing, right? So anything that's applied, it needs extensive testing. It needs security, because it is money associated. As you get, you know, into the Web3 more, moving lots of resources, you really, everybody will want to hack you. And that basically means, you know, security becomes an important ingredient in your code. So you shouldn't, your smart contracts, whatever you write, should not have, you know, loopholes. Again, in the current, you are not gonna, you know, we're not asking you to write that very secure blah blah, but you need to understand the difference between what is in Web3 programming, what is building a web app, just what you just did in Web4. When you go, you know, what are the, so tests becomes important, and resources becomes limited, because you are running usually on chains, distributed chains. That means everything costs, memory costs, as well as computation really costs, like very expensive. It's not like a cloud that you have like one computer, you pay something, but it's just that, you know, the chain is expensive. And then there are terminologies on chain and outside chain, because some things are stored off the chain. When it's off the chain, there are two things. One is like a distributed file system, and then as well as also just basically some other off chain, which is like, for example, you know, and in it could be a physical property, things like that. But you need to understand them. So the current project is somehow gives you a bit more time. It's not so demanding. It would give you a bit more time to understand those concepts. And then, but the project in itself, what it does is like, we as Ten Academy want to build an app, basically a web app that allows Arun or Everest or Mary or anyone who's kind of assigned for that, they want to just be able to open, just like they open the NX system, they open this link. It could be web3.tenacademy.org, and then they want, so they basically will have a feature in that application where they are, for example, they are able to monitor who is kind of completed a certain, you know, who satisfied a certain condition. And if they satisfy, and if they now are like at the end, so one of our requirements is that everybody finishes the project, at least every of the 12, whatever, the 10 projects, you know, with a certain threshold. And when you do that, then you are able to request, as you know, so that means you as a trainee, is able to request a certificate, a digital certificate. It's an it's called in the current sense, it's called NFT, non-fungible tokens. And then they will approve. And when they approve that one, you will receive your token, your basically NFT. And that NFT, it is frozen. That means you can't, because this is just a certificate and this cannot be traded. That means you cannot send it or sell it to another person, but you own it. But because you own the certificate, you are entitled for a certain rewards. For example, we might ask for everyone who has that certificate, you know, companies can donate, right? So when the companies donate, then you must have like now the donation, as well as also how much 10 Academy would get from that donation, how much a person to whom the donation, like to the certificate that the donation, how much that would get will be controlled by a smart contract. The whole point is usually, you know, it's we're not expecting simple outside crowdfunding, but it may be that when a company hires you, just they wanted to, for example, acknowledge that 10 Academy trains them cheap and they want to support 10 Academy, they might want to donate. The person, you know, the client or the company who's hiring you might donate. In that sense, it's the same as like for us, great, you know, because you were so good and the company was so happy, let's say that, you know, they donated. Of course, 10 Academy would use that one to train further, but also you might, in the future, you might also, like you have also a certain cut, right? So, and then you can request to pull it because you are the owner of that certificate. But it's not only that, we will use it a lot and lot. The smart contract, we might change, but the certificate, basically like the digital certificate, the NFT, you will then have a certain action or possibilities. So we want to be able to have a certificate owner to ask first, if before the set of they own the certificate, to ask to own, like that means they, I am finished, I am done, give me my certificate. 10 Academy team to be able to send that for you. Basically, then you become the owner. And then a smart contract that is associated to that NFT will be able to control. So after that, when you are, you know, querying it, or when you are doing some operation, it's called messaging. When you message it, based on what is written in that smart contract, you would receive something. It could be a transaction, it could be anything, right? So we want a web app that would facilitate this. We will start very simple. We need a wallet to integrate as our own authenticator, and then be able to generate NFT based on a certificate, you know, certificate in this case is what we prepared digitally, you know, and which will have its own, our own unique ID, blah, blah. And then to send that one when it's requested. So your basically task is very simple, same as the audio that, you know, you have an audio, someone will upload, whatever, this one will be just only addition will be some kind of authentication, but also being able to connect with the mainnet or testnet. That means to blockchain, right? So that makes it what is web app. And then you will also probably write, if you have time, a smart contract that will do a very simple task. In this case would be just, it will allow you to kind of ask for transaction of a certain case if there is donation. So that's a simple ask. It may be a bit, now when I describe it, it may be not clear, but when you look at the project, it becomes easy. But just the whole thing is written in this business need. You don't need much. There's no data, particular data you are analyzing. You are actually, but we encourage you to explore and visualize the blockchain data so that you can understand what is a transaction, what is a block, you know, what, you know, using block explorers and connecting with the testnet as well as also with the mainnet, you're able to basically get data, how nodes are created, what are the data that are available. Because you are a data scientist, you can actually, for understanding, can explore and visualize, and you can put it in your notebook. We'll definitely be happy to see that. The expected outcome is, of course, but the mostly what is here that you're gonna be spending most of your time understanding, as well as building front-end, back-end API solutions, right? So connecting with different third-party APIs, as well as building APIs, basically that would expose for you to do from the backend, and then a front end that would basically query the backend to do something, right? The actions. Basically, that's all. Anything around that, that's what is the skill that you will be learning. Extensive unit testing and building what is what makes a web app three. You will know much more when you work on it. Okay, the competencies, just it's a reminder what are like the competencies we are tracking. Usually you see the updates every time in your 10x system. There is the radar plots, so your upgrade, your progress in that area will be there. So for now, for example, yeah, last week you had these two, deep learning being the main, and this time the web and mobile app programming basically become one of the main in this case, as well as, yeah, so basically, and then this one plus the web three. I didn't add it, but I will add web three. A part is now added. In the past, because we never touched about web three, there wasn't the web three shown, but there will be web three now. Okay. These are basically the competencies we track all the time. The team, the time, I think by now it's very familiar. The leaderboard, again, this is very much a lot of the presentation is to help us that to understand, to know that you understand, as well as also for you to be able to explain it to people, to yourself, because if you can explain it to people, that means you are able, you understand it well, and you can explain it to employers as well. And kind of the interim submission involves the principles of blockchain, smart contracts, and NFTs, you know, what they mean. You should be very clear by then. And then also the stack, the Web3 technology stack, basically distinguishing it, for example, what are elements that are different from Web2, and then basically just the plan, as well as the work that has been done. Final submission, as usual. The only thing that the clear section is on the business value and the technology stack that used, you know, what kind of front end, back end, APIs, whatever that is used. So it's basically you will describe clearly, you know, the process you have followed, and then also it's like, okay, then finally, what does your web app does? The summary of what has been achieved, its implication, and whether the objectives of the project met or not, you would basically comment on that. And on the technical kind of like coding side, we would definitely really look, main point are testings and GitHub actions. You should be now not just add them as a fulfillment only, but really you should start thinking about them. Okay, so this is not ML, this is actually. MCICD, basically just the rest are okay. So it's design sandbox in the entry. So basically the sandbox implementation, you would see more detail, like screenshots, whatever you will have to submit for that. And then on the final, basically, we expect that at least you have connected with the mainnet and did something. Your web, your front end is connected with a wallet, so it can authenticate with that, and that your front end is functional and responsive, and your backend is good and exposes multi good APIs with good code quality, right? Okay. So no group work. So at first we thought it might help, but I think, you know, given that everyone now works and helps each other, it's fine. You will do all the work yourself. Of course, as usual, you help each other, right? Whoever is good in front end helps others, you know, the back end helps others, but everything that you will be working individually for this work. And this will give you a good chance as well for you to go end to end, front end, back end, and API connections, as well as also understanding the concept. So instruction, so this is basically is the main, right? So it is slightly less detailed than the usual that you see, and mostly because it's just a description of, you know, what you need to do. So that's why it doesn't need more than that. It doesn't need like, okay, the data, look at this, whatever, but much more of like a task, much more of this one you can actually take it as part of, you know, a sprint, and each task being some kind of project or a sub project, and each of the subtasks basically as your tickets that you will work on, or as your kind of epic that you will be using and split them to work on. So task one is really a lot more. You have to understand and explore the Algorand API or the Algorand and Sandbox. So basically, just first understanding, you should set up a GitHub repo and also just choose which one. Even if you don't know React, maybe it's time to learn a little bit of JavaScript. But if you are very, very like unhappy to learn anything now new because you are already overwhelmed, of course, you can use some other Python, like including Streamlit, right? So it's okay. Just you can use it as your front end, something that will help you basically browser, and that would query some API. And then as a backend, definitely, because Python is so good for a backend, front end is very, Python is not that good, at least for now. PyScript is coming. If you want to learn something that's really cutting edge now coming for Python, that's PyScript. It's still in the experimental state. It's not like fully fledged yet, but it can run in the web browser now without anything, just like any other JavaScript, it can run. Yeah, but React and JavaScript and all other, you know, front-end languages maybe is a good place to start. And then for the back-end, you have different choices, Flask, FastAPI, Django. And if you are also just prefer, you can also use Node.js for that as well. So, but just choose and kind of stick with that because you don't have that much time. It's better to just choose it now and follow just whatever you manage to do with that is better. And then, of course, you have already maybe tried, run Algorand Sandbox, explore it by creating whatever using the documentation, as well as also we would expect some kind of your screenshots of your terminal, as well as also what you manage to display using the dApp flow. And then also just somehow your connections and query account information in the testnet. This would be like kind of up to basically Wednesday, you should be able to finish all that. And also part of this. And then in the front end and back end development, of course, you know, basically the strategy is that you don't really build everything once you have the data. So you can actually design, you can start design. Design means just like you only put it in basically some design framework, like, you know, Figma or just a paper or something. And then from that, you can actually the logic, everything, you can make it static data. That means you just only test the implementation of it, you know, put where it is, whatever in the browser. And so you can build them separately. So that's why just here is just a small tip for you. But what you need is just you need to design and implement backend, which consists of course, the backend logic, you know, the API endpoints, the different endpoints you want to expose for your case. And as the Python backend code tests, like you can use PyTest for that. And then smart contract tests. If you are writing smart contracts, you can also look at PyTeal. This is the Algorand PyTest. And then design front end which will satisfy the following user stories. As I said, user stories are the way to tell, like to design, for example, because the user basically, as the name says, it's a user story. You want to plan it according to how a user will go through or will have needs and the journey in the system you're designing, right? So you can think of it as roles in part. So when a user enters, they will have a role that is assigned for them. It could be an admin, for example, in this case, Athena Academy admin, right? So that, let's call it a staff role will allow them. So when they log in, okay, they will now we pointed to one endpoint, then that means they are able to see and to distribute, to create, to mint and distribute NFTs. And if it's a trainee that is logged in, of course, then they have two things. They can opt in to an NFT certificate because they say, okay, you know, I have done everything. You know, you have the 10X system has my everything. So please just issue my certificate. And of course, which that means is that a staff which will be receiving the opt-in from the trainee, the opt-in usually will have a public key. So that you will associate a public key for that opt-in. And then a staff that sees that one will of course approve or decline, because by going to 10X, for example, they look, okay, what you have submitted, everything is good. Then in that case, they would basically then distribute or send you the NFT as your owner. So basically you just, as if you traded, you do some kind of transaction. in Algorand, an NFT will have four addresses, and one of the address, basically it means like one of the address will change just so that you become the owner of it. And then a trainee is able to check the approval or denial of their request, and hope if there's a comment that's associated, that would be also nice, right? So basically now you will have two roles so far, right? A staff that is able to see a request, basically mint an NFT and distribute or basically transfer it to a trainee, and a trainee was able to see the and to able to request, as well as also be able to see if their request is granted or not. And then another one is that of course a trainee would be able to, from the same system, can actually request for a withdrawal, because they would see how much for their NFT, for their token, or whatever they're entitled to based on the smart contract, the value associated to it. And then also, like a company, just they can come to the website, and that means they don't need to authenticate, but they are able to donate. And if they donate, basically they may choose to which NFT that they are donating to, or to which smart contract they are donating to, or to which account. Basically, when we say NFT, smart contract, all of them are accounts. Okay, great. So that's the front end and back end. Of course, you connect it, all of this, then to make it work all, because you know, whatever we say here, the back end implements the logic, the front end is basically displaying that logic, and then basically you will have the testing, the CI, the GitHub Actions, all deployment. When you improve, for example, your code, it needs to go into, like, you have to commit it. When you're committed, it will just run the test. If you make a mistake, of course, the test will fail, you know, things like that. Whatever you have been doing so far in Git, basically also the front end must have authentication, and that authentication is through a wallet. So you need to connect also with a wallet. Okay. And then the third task, the important part, is of course putting the logic in the blockchain. So you basically now, okay, great. All of this is just back end, front end coming in here and there, connecting with both, but the back end must do some of its logic. They must, for example, go to the Algorand blockchain or Algorand node, a main node or test node, whichever you are implementing. Basically, it has to extract information about that NFT, the owner, or information. So that basically needs to be associated as well. That means there has to be connection. You have to query the Algorand blockchain or a node, and as well as also maybe this authentication wallet integration. You may implement it inside like the backend or inside the front end, and that has to happen, the logic for that integration, and the kind of, at least in one way, whatever how you integrate it, you must know the role must be defined by the backend. So that basically means you may have endpoints, API endpoints, that says it's a team, or it's a trainee, or it's a public or a generic request. So it needs to have that one. So that basically means the backend needs to be aware, you know, which wallet you have integrated, if the person has already authenticated through that. So that means all the requests after that will go through. So that means that you will have to handle that connection, as well as also when a staff is minting a certificate, you have to provide them that. Basically they should, from the front end, they basically have to create an NFT, which means that you would basically connect with the Algorand node. You do all the kind of things that is needed, and you authenticate. Okay, great. And then after that, you basically write all the process as a blog, as usual. Tutorials will focus blockchain concept and Web3 technology today. We might change it just in, like, I will confirm again, but I think it should be fine. I'll take you through at least the main concepts, as well as also what are the kind of in Algorand, you know, how do you implement some of these things? I mean, just conceptually. And there will be PyTest and PyTeal tomorrow. And then also the wallet integration, why and how, that will be on Wednesday. And on Thursday, we will ask actually the 10X team who's building the 10X, the three, the design, the front end and back end, how things are done in 10X, so that you have some exposure if you haven't already. So That's it. And the submission basically Wednesday as usual, and Saturday the final. And here we have put some references, so you can start from them. You know, most of these references are just, sometimes you have also just Git package. For example, this one, this really shows, I mean, if you look at this, you know, it's basically, where is it? You know, if you look at the live demo, it really builds everything. You know, it's a React thing. It's basically, that's what the kind of front end, you know, you can copy this or you can build on top of this. You can connect wallet, you know, and then after that, you can choose the certificate. For example, if I am a role to mint, basically I choose a certificate and then I give it a name, whatever is required, a description, and I can show some extra parameters. You know, these are what controls. That's the manager address, the reverse address, the cloud address, the freeze address. This is what I was saying. In an NFT has, can be associated to smart contracts in different ways. The manager can be a one smart contract, the reserve, you know, what is what reserve address, whatever, you will learn more with the cloud address and the freeze address. So these are the smart contracts, the stateful or stateless contracts can actually get connected to it. So that's what, when we say like a smart contract can be associated, and that smart contract can control what, you know, what things to do. So it's basically, just basically you can build on top of that. And then after that, you can mint, right? And then this will be like a role in this case of the staff to mint a certificate. Okay, so, you know, as example like that, you will have, and the Git code is just here, you know, for doing that. It's a basically a TypeScript. Okay, great. Or just React based the thing. So that's it. Hopefully it's clear and it will get more clearer as you go. Any question? If not, yeah, I will activate the AWS machine so that you guys can, whoever has data or whoever needs to do something, they will have until 8 p.m. So it's actually, it will be 9 here, so it's like 7 p.m. UTC. So, and I will just detail the time it will be when it's up, and then also when I'll take it down. So it will, you will have enough time. So at least for about 6 hours you will have. Great. Cheers, guys. Then with that, there are no questions. Yeah, that doesn't.
Okay, sorry. Thank you for your presentation. Are we going to use AWS for this project or our local machine?
Your local machine, yeah. Yeah. And based on that, maybe at the end we might adopt it and deploy it if you do. Good work. We might then be able to help deploy a few that manage to do it, so that, you know, because it's our main interest, so we may keep it and we may deploy it in our AWS if you have done that.
Okay. And the other thing is maybe the tutors may help us on doing this new technology, so I hope they will consider us as a novice learner. I mean, for this one, and
the one thing I can tell you is that I think the tutors also, it is mostly new, so of course they had some time to look at it earlier, but and some people, so we assigned such that some people use their previous experience, if they had a back-end experience, front-end experience like that, but I think it's a co-learning. This is clearly a co-learning. That means everyone, I mean, the conceptual thing, we have a clear understanding. Experience-wise, it is going to be an interesting one, because a lot of the people here don't have, I mean, I don't have, for example, particularly industry standard skill for that. I know I explore and I understand and I build some small things, but I don't have also that. But then what we are guided is by people who are in the industry. right? So Cosimo, you have seen, you know, he works for Algorand and he develops a lot. So we have people who can advise us and who also designed this challenge. But I think what is going to be interesting is that it's going to be a co-learning, and everyone, we have people that will do the front end, the back end, the concept, and we will be as a team by the end, it will just be demystified. I think, you know, what Web3 is, just Web3 builds on top of Web2 with basically a certain concepts needed, like, or changed, right? For security, for example, or distributed system handling. But the rest, you still are going to use Python, you still are going to use React or something, you still are going to use some tests, you still are going to, you know, write in a certain way. So it's not that different from what we have done. And also the good thing is that as all of this opportunity will make you actually, even if you are not going to be in Web3, but this is, as a machine learning engineer or as a, you know, a data engineer, you are going to be better with this, because the technology, the deployment is the same wherever you are. So in a way, it will help overall. And if you are going to be in Web3, this is really a good project, because this is going to be a demonstrable project. That means that that's something that really has every piece. And then as in the next ones, we will, of course, start reworking on smart contracts that actually will have security issues, as well as also tests to be really the main element, as well as they will interact with physical systems like sensors. So that would be the next project and Web3. But this is a good, like, handleable, because Algorand, you don't need to write smart contracts for NFT. In others like Ethereum, they don't support NFT on what we call on the chain, but actually it's a smart contract that will act like an NFT. So here it's, everything is simple. You know, if you don't need to write anything new, it's like the same as any token generation. So this is simpler. But you can, of course, write optionally a smart contract to control, to have some actions with that NFT. So it will be, ultimately what I want to say, that it will be a co-learning. So definitely it's going to be exciting to get into this world. Yeah.
Yes, I got it.
Great, Daisy.
Mine is there maybe like a particular preference to Algorand over all the other platforms like Ethereum?
So the first thing is that we have support from Algorand. To the Cosimo is from Algorand, and he of course only could help in Algorand. So that's why we went to Algorand. But no, it's basically, I think Algorand is supporting us in some way, in both now for the next, as well as also for this one in terms of skill. But we have been also in contact with others who work on other blockchains, and we're not gonna be like only learn Algorand. I think this will be on Algorand, but the next project most likely will be in Ethereum. Yeah, does that answer, Daisy?
Yes, it does.
Yeah. But Algorand makes it very easy, actually, for some of these things, because they support what's called on Level 1, which is basically the chain on the blockchain. So you are in one, it's fast transaction to mint an NFT. It's just, that's it. It's like the same as buying a token in Ethereum, you know, which is, while in Ethereum to get a token, you actually have to write a smart contract that would basically act like your token. Your NFT. So it's different. You need more work to generate an NFT in Ethereum, while here it's just the same as buying a coin, or, you know. So it's that makes it simpler. Okay, great. Hopefully all these questions will be addressed as we go, and by the end we all will feel the differences and the intricacies, and we will be more prepared, and hopefully we will also produce something that's really valid, valuable to Tena Academy. Great, thanks guys, and yeah, we can stop the recording. Bye.